Luke chapter 20, verse 9. He went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, "May this never be." Jesus looked directly at them and asked, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become a capstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed." The teachers of the law and the chief priests looked for a way to arrest him immediately, because they knew he had spoken this parable against them, but they were afraid of the people. Keeping a close watch on him, they sent spies who pretended to be honest. They hoped to catch Jesus in something he said so they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor. Amen.
I didn't have time to print off a sermon, so I just downloaded one from the internet. I hope that's okay with you guys. No, I'm just, and I'm preaching just the sermon I preached last week at our church. And, you know, sometimes when you visit a church, you want to go back and pull that sermon that you preached 6 years ago that people thought was just amazing. And so I just like to preach whatever I preached the week before, and that seems to work pretty well. Thank you for having us, or me. My wife's not here right now, but it's been several years since I was here, and last time I was here, I just had a great time. Spending time with you guys and getting to know your church and teaching and preaching. And we are going through a hard time. Our family is, as Peter said, we're transitioning out of New Zealand back to America. And that's hard because we love it here and we love the people. And we're very attached to our church and the work of God here. And the conversations we're having are really hard. And last Sunday, we have an African widow, and she buried her husband several years ago in Christchurch, and she comes up to me. She says, "Oh, Pastor, I didn't know if I could talk to you this morning." And I said, "Oh, how are you doing?" And she said, "I lost my husband. Now I lose my pastor." You know, and you just want to just rip up those tickets, don't you? It's a hard time for us. And so we really appreciate and we covet your prayers with this transition. Luke chapter 20, verses 9 to 20. I want to give you some background, what's happened before, so you can be up to speed about what we're talking about this morning. It's the Passover season. And what that means is, you know, the Jews would celebrate the Passover annually, where they would get a lamb, an unblemished lamb, and they would take it to the temple, and it would be approved and sacrificed for the sins of their entire family. And if you can picture it, during this season, there'd be 270,000 lambs descending upon Jerusalem, upon the temple. And there in the midst of that is Jesus, the Lamb of God, coming to the temple, coming to be the sacrifice for us. Now, it's probably the second or third day here of the Passover, and he's teaching. And it's important because all the religious leaders are there, and they're listening because they're wondering, is he going to pronounce himself the king, the Messiah, the Savior? And so they ask him this: hey, what if, by what authority are you doing these things? And what they mean is, why did you come into the temple yesterday, turn over the tables, and drive out the money changers? Who gave you the authority to do that? Jesus doesn't just answer their question. He says, well, let me just ask you a question. And he turns it back on them. Was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? And then he's talking about John the Baptist. And it seems random, but it's not random at all. It's quite brilliant. You see, John the Baptist was a deeply loved prophet. And if they said, well, he's a prophet, and his baptism, what he was doing in the desert, was from God, then that meant what he said about Jesus was from God as well. Right? So Jesus was the Messiah. He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And therefore, that's where his authority comes from. But if they say, no, John's not a prophet, then they've got a problem with the crowd because the crowd deeply loved him. And so their response is, we don't know. Right? Pretty cowardly response. Jesus then says, well, neither am I going to tell you where my authority comes from. But he does do this. He tells them a parable about where his authority comes from. His authority comes from the fact that he is the Son, the only Son and the beloved Son of an almighty God. So we've already read the text, and if you'll just pray with me one more time. Father, thank you for the Son, and we need to behold his glory. Lord, like a plant needs beams of light from the sun, Lord, so do we need to behold the glory of Christ. Lord, just like light is how we understand the world that we live in, so understanding Jesus gives us understanding of the world and of ourselves. Lord, and I thank you, Jesus, that you are the Son, and you teach this great parable just before you go to the cross about your authority. And that is an authority that we can take deep refuge in when we're struggling with wondering if we're really saved, and then also when we have difficult times. So we ask that your Holy Spirit would teach, would illuminate our minds right now, help us to know in an intimate way our Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's a really important question they ask him. By what authority are you doing these things? Right? Very legitimate question. His answer is, I am the Son sent with the authority of my Father in heaven. In those days, to be the Son was to have the authority of the Father. To be the very cornerstone of man's salvation, he tells us. Now, here's why that is very important. I'm going to backtrack and give you some history. When the Temple of Solomon, the original temple, was built, the giant stones for the walls were not chiseled out there. They were made at the quarry, and then they were brought over. And the story goes, it's told from one particular rabbi, an ancient story, that they brought a giant stone over from the quarry that had been chiseled out, but it was much too big for their purposes. And so when the builders saw the stone, and they said, this stone's unusable, and they set it out in the field. In other words, they rejected the stone. And there it sat for some time. Weeds grew around it until they needed a cornerstone. And when they needed a cornerstone, they began to look for the perfect stone. Now, the cornerstone was very, very important for the building. In fact, the whole temple depended upon the cornerstone because the weight of it literally rested on that. The angles of it were utterly dependent upon the cornerstone. And if you had a cornerstone that had any imperfections at all, over time it would crack or dissolve or break, and the whole building would be in trouble. Now, they were unable to find just the right stone until they turned and remembered and began to examine the stone that they had rejected, still in the fields. And when they got it and began to examine it, they found out that it was exactly what they were looking for, and it fit perfectly and became the very cornerstone of Solomon's temple. Now, in Luke 20, when Jesus tells the story of the vineyard that we just read, he is answering the question, where does my authority come from? And what he says is, it comes from the owner of the vineyard who sent me. I am the Son of God, he's saying. come to call for the fruits of righteousness from his people. But he doesn't stop there. He takes a step further back and he quotes Psalm 118. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. A very prophecy about the Messiah who, like the temple stone, would be rejected by men, but is the very cornerstone set apart by God with all the authority of God for the salvation and the transformation of man. Now, God has sent Jesus to be the authority over the church, over his people. The church is the vineyard, you might say. He is the vine. You and I, if we're believers, are the branches. Another way to say that from this text is the church is the building and he is the cornerstone. This means God the Father has said his Son is completely qualified to recover man to himself. To this task, the Son was faithful to the Father to the very end, and that all he ever did or was done in love to his Father and for his sheep. Last thing, it is the authority of Jesus which gives the Christian great comfort and security. Because without the authority of God, Christ's death would mean nothing because we're not sure it was actually commissioned by God. But because he's the Son, commissioned, sent, approved, we know that he has the authority to also be the cornerstone of our salvation. So here's the main idea today is this. If you're taking notes, please write this down. The Son's authority is the servant's refuge. The Son's authority is your refuge and my refuge where we go and hide and shelter ourselves in difficult times. Okay? Should we dive in the text? Now, at my church, they say yes. Okay, should we dive in the text?
Yes.
Good. You got a little Baptist blood in you, I see there. Sorry. Amen. That's right. Okay, to understand this authority, we need to examine this parable and what follows. And we're going to just look at several different aspects and just work our way through. First is this. Here's point one. The vineyard and its owner. The vineyard and its owner. So look in your Bibles with me. I'll just read. A certain man planted a vineyard, leased it to vine dressers, and went into a far country for a long time. Now I'm going to read the same story in Matthew 21. He planted a vineyard and set a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Now notice those words. Do you see those words? A certain man planted a vineyard. So there was no existing vineyard there. It means this man took a hillside. He cleared the stones. He terraced it. He put a wall around it with thorns on top of it. And then he built a watchtower in the back. And you say, why a watchtower? Well, so you didn't get robbed. And so when the grapes were ripe, they put a two-story watchtower in the back and they would hire a family to live there in the watchtower during the harvest season to watch over and to care. Therefore, it's called a watchtower, right? To watch over what was happening in the vineyard. Now, Luke 14 refers about the expense of this watchtower, and it says, which of you intending to build a building does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish? That's referring to a watchtower because it was so expensive to build. Now, he didn't just do all this work and put in the watchtower. He also put in a wine press, which was a cistern cut from solid rock with a hole in the middle where the juice would run out. And so this is what you need to notice. The owner turned an ordinary hillside into a working, productive vineyard. Okay? Now, when Jesus says a certain man planted a vineyard, the religious leaders that he's talking to knew exactly what he was talking about. He's talking about verses like Psalm 80, verses 8 and 9. Listen to this. You brought a vine out of Egypt, speaking about God. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took deep root and filled the land. Listen, my friends, the Jews deeply identified with being God's vine, with bearing the fruits of God to show his glory to the world. In fact, when Jesus is teaching, he's there in front of the temple. And do you know what is engraved on the side of the temple? A vine. Yeah, a massive vine coming around into the Holy of Holies. And Jesus is teaching, and they get it. They understand quite clearly that they are the vine. But we get that too, don't we? If you're from New Zealand, we identify with being Kiwis, right? If you're Canadian, you identify with being maple leaves. Oh, maple leaves. If you're from Australia, you identify with dingoes, right? See, sorry, Americans are being a little cheeky too. You know, when I said that last week in our church, they didn't think that was funny at all. They didn't laugh at me. Sorry, because we have so many Australians. Okay, let's move now to point two. That is the tenants. Look in your Bibles at verse 9. The owner of the vineyard goes away, and then he leases it to these tenants. Verse 9. And he let it out to tenants and went into another country for a long while. The vineyard owner left home, and he leased it to caretakers or tenants. Now, what's going on here? Well, Israel is the vine. The tenants are the very ones that Jesus is talking to, these religious leaders that are standing in front of him, the priests and the scribes who are called to care for God's people until the Messiah comes. But there's more to this story. In those days, if a group lived on a piece of land for 3 or more years without paying tax or rent on it, they could claim the title as theirs. That's important to understand. But by paying or giving anything, it showed and it recognized that the land was not theirs. So rent maintained title. You get that? Rent maintained title. So what we are about to see here in this situation is who has the authority over God's people? That's what's happening. Is it God or is it the religious leaders? Is it his vineyard? Is it his people? Or is it about the religious leaders and their rules, their regulations, their commercialization of how God's house of worship is running? If you're a Christian, Jesus gives you the same identity. You have an identity far greater than being a maple leaf or a kiwi or whatever it might be. If you're a Christian, you're part of the vine. He's the vine, you're the branches. He's grafted you into God's people. I had a good friend in America who's a horticulturalist, and he had a section in the back of his house, and he had these beautiful fruit trees. And I would come around when he was picking fruit, and I always noticed these amazing trees and all these varieties. But on the base, there'd be like a knot or a little twist in the trunk. And I was just learning about fruit trees, and I said, you know, what's going on there? And he said, well, what I do when I plant these is I get vigorous, strong root stock. And then I get a certain variety of pear or plum or apple, and I graft it into that. And because it's grafted in, it draws the sap, it draws the water from this strong fruit, and it grows and it becomes this amazing fruit tree. That's you and me, okay? We're not ethnically Jewish, probably, but we are the wild branches grafted into the promises of the covenant of grace, righteous by faith alone because we are joined to the vine, to the Son. Paul says it like this in Romans 11:17. If some of the branches are broken off and you, although a wild olive shoot, were grafted in amongst the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, don't be arrogant toward the branches. Paul is warning us, don't be like the tenants who in their pride refuse to submit to the authority of the landowner. The warning here is, my friends, be humble. Your salvation is solely by grace. You have no cause to boast or look down on other believers. You are the wild vine that was grafted in, and our salvation is not because of us or how much fruit we produce. It's because we're joined to the vine. It's because we rest upon the cornerstone, and that's it alone. Let's go to the third thing. Let's move from the tenants to the servants and the son, and we'll finish up here. Verses 10 to 13 with me in your Bibles. Verses 10 to 13. The question is one of authority, right? Are you getting that picture? Whose vineyard is it? If the tenants can keep from paying any kind of rent or harvest, then they might be able to make a claim on the vineyard. It might be theirs. Do you get that picture? You understand that? So what does the owner do? First, he sends the three servants. The first two are beaten. The Greek here means repeatedly. They're wounded and they're cast out to die. Now notice the third is wounded and he's cast out to die. And the owner of the vineyard says this, "What shall I do? I'll send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." The son came to plead the terms of the agreement, right? He came to call them back to the agreement that they had originally made, the covenant, you might say, to call them to fruits of repentance. Their response is, the tenants, they deliberated, which means literally they planned it out. It wasn't spontaneous. And if they said, if we kill him, the vineyard will be theirs. Now, notice this with me. The son is not only beloved, but he's the only son. Okay, that's important. For if he dies, there is no other heir. And what is implied here, you see these two great terms that describe this son. He's beloved, which we see used again and again in the description of Jesus. When the Father speaks over him, the Mount of Transformation, this is my beloved son. But not only that, he's the only son. Because if he dies, there's no other heir. And so Jesus is describing the son who comes as deeply beloved by his father, having the authority of his father, and the only son. You get the picture he's painting, right? Now remember, he is speaking to the leaders of Israel, and they knew the scriptures. They knew Israel was the vine. They knew God was the owner. They knew that they were the tenants, Jewish leaders and kings who for years had mistreated God's people. They understood quite clearly that he's describing them, the religious leaders, as killing and beating the servants, probably the prophets. And the last of the prophets would have been John the Baptist, who had just been killed by King Herod. All that's fresh. John had just been killed, the last of the prophets. They got it. They understood. The message was incredibly clear. But what about the last part? God has a son? And sent to call God's people to faith and repentance, and this son would be killed by the very leaders of Israel? This part of the story had not yet happened, but before the week was out, it would. Now, what will the owner do? This is how Jesus closes this story. In the face of all these leaders, he asked the crowd, "And what will the owner do to the vine dressers?" The response is, they say, what's going to happen? He will come and destroy those vine dressers and give the vineyard to others. Jesus looks directly at them and he quotes Psalm 118. The very psalm people had, let me just give some context. This is really cool. Jesus had just ridden into the town 2 to 3 days earlier on a colt. And do you know what psalm they would have been singing? Psalm 118. Right? That was the song they sang during the Passover when people came into the city. And so Jesus comes back to that song. And so they were singing things like, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now Jesus gives them the rest of the psalm. The stone that the builder rejected is becoming the cornerstone. And so what he's saying is, yes, we're singing this great psalm about coming into the city. And I am the cornerstone. I am the fulfillment. In other words, I am the Son of God, the cornerstone of salvation, the Lamb of God, the vine of God's grace. I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is his authority and his commission from the Father. And his works, his teachings, his miracles, his fulfilling all the prophecies of the Old Testament, telling about this Messiah that was going to come. And his resurrection shows that he's right. And he does have the authority that he says. So to reject the Son is to reject the Father's love and to be left, like Jesus says, with only great judgment. And he warns in the very end here, he closes, that if you reject him as the cornerstone, that you will be crushed in eternity. Those are very hard words because you're rejecting God's grace and his love for you. One of the things that makes me love God even more is the incredible mercy he had on the tenants. You ever think of that? Bearing with them, giving them opportunity after opportunity to obey their covenant, their responsibilities. I went to high school with a boy named Toby, my best friend. Toby came from a Christian home. He was the first one to actually invite me to church because I came from a very wild non-Christian family. He invited me to church, invited me to youth group, things like probably like you do here, and first exposed me to the gospel. Well, when we were about 16, Toby began to do quite a few drugs and just get wilder and wilder and wilder and wilder off the path. He got hooked on crystal meth when we were about 18 years old, and went into rehab. And this is when I was leaving home. Went into rehab for quite a while. His parents, these wonderful Christian people, loved him deeply. They brought him out of rehab, brought him into home, brought him to church with us. The first thing he did was get a young girl in the church pregnant. And then he went back into rehab. For the next 15 years, he was in and out of rehab for his crystal meth addiction. And I talked to his mother several years ago, and I said, "How's he doing? Tell me about Toby. What's going on with him?" And she says, "The same story. He's still hooked on drugs, still abusing. He's shacked up with girl after girl after girl. He's in and out of rehabs." But what was remarkable is the family never disowned him. They had hard love for him, no doubt. But they always showed him the mercy of God. They sent him back to rehab. They continued to give him the word of God. They continued to bring him under the church and hoping that the gospel would transform him. Their mercy never finished. Now, the vineyard owner could have brought force, couldn't he, right? But his mercy continued until they rejected his Son. He had mercy again and again and again upon them until they rejected his Son. For 1,400 years, Israel broke the covenant that God made with them, yet he never took the kingdom from them. They were still his people. In his loving mercy, he sent messenger again and again and again, prophet after prophet after prophet. And finally, he sent his Son, and they rejected him. How do we think and live this? Let's take this from our head to our hearts, which is what we do at our church, and we'll just close with two last thoughts to help you think and live this week. First is this: God is still merciful to us. Amen? Amen. Yes. Sometimes I see a tenant heart in me, and you probably see a tenant heart in you, not wanting to submit my life, my decisions to the authority of Jesus, not wanting to follow or obey him, but to do what I want to do, not wanting to produce any types of fruits of righteousness. And what does he do when he sees that tenant heart in you and in me, when we reject the urgings of the Spirit? The same thing he's always done. He calls us back to himself through word and spirit. The Holy Spirit gives you grace in two great ways. First, he gives you the graces that God has promised you when you put your faith in Christ. We call this the new birth, regeneration. You're born again. He gives you a new nature. And what's new is Jesus is in you. That's what's new. giving you new desires and changing you from the inside out. Like those prophets of old, calling you to avoid sin, calling you to the Father, to have confidence to come to Him. But the Holy Spirit's work doesn't just stop there. The Spirit of Christ goes on, and He helps us to continually submit to the authority of Jesus over our lives. And He does that by working like a flashlight or torch in your life. We call this illumination, shining upon all that Jesus has done for us so that you can understand it, so that you can love Him more. This is what happens when you read the Scriptures. The Spirit illuminates it, so you go, wow, what a Savior, what a cornerstone. And then you love Him more, you want to trust Him more, and you want to obey Him more. That's the work of the Holy Spirit in you. And He does that sometimes when we have a tenant's heart, and that's His grace to you and to me because we're His children by faith. Second is this, His authority is our refuge. And we'll close with this. Jesus' authority as the Son, accepted by the Father, is your refuge. A jealous heart like the tenants fights every inch of Jesus' authority over their lives. A jealous heart like the tenants, they fight every inch of Jesus' authority over their lives. But what they miss is seeing His authority is the best. It's the believer's refuge in hard times. Here's what I mean. His authority is your refuge and salvation first. Jesus had the full authority of God, and He was sent by God to reconcile you and me to Himself. The resurrection is the proof of that. This gives us the greatest comfort and security in knowing that on my best day, I am righteous before Christ only for the righteousness of Jesus given to me and received by faith alone, not because of anything I do. On my worst day, I am righteous in His sight only for the righteousness of Jesus given to me and received by faith alone. I rest in that. That's His authority to proclaim that's true about your life and mine, and I refuge in that. His authority to say, yes, you are righteous, but only because you've received me in my righteousness. Second, and this is the last thought. His authority is my refuge in knowing God's pleasure controls God's power. Listen, God's pleasure controls God's power. God's pleasure is the only rule according to which God's power works in your life and in the world. This means when extraordinary difficulties press in on you and all your ways of escape seem closed, we rest in His authority over our lives and leave ourselves to His good pleasure, knowing that He has sovereign purposes in everything He does and does not do. And all His ways are good. For His pleasure and the good of His people, His power always works. So in the midst of the hardest of times, when all the portals of escape seem to be closed, I can rest that God is good. And all that He does ends up in good, even though it might be extraordinarily painful and difficult right now. And that's an authority of God over this world that we can rest in and refuge in. Amen? Lord, I praise You for the Savior Christ. Lord, and I thank You that You sent a cornerstone. He's the vine. He's the lamb. I see that picture of 270,000 lambs coming to be slaughtered for the sins of Israel. And there is Your lamb. Every family brought one, and You brought one. The Lamb of God that the prophet John proclaimed to be the Lamb of God, the cornerstone, Lord, and for everyone who with a heart of repentance and trust and rest looks to Him will be saved. And not only that, will be filled with the Holy Spirit and radically changed desires, changed nature, changed identity. Lord, thank you for this good news to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.